Here at River Road, we are a Unitarian Universalist congregation. I am aware of the fact that the above statement may in fact win a prize for the most glaringly obvious opening sentence of any sermon ever. And yet, even some of us who have been here for years, some of us who have been serving and connecting and growing and weeping alongside one another even for decades, even we sometimes actually wonder what it is exactly that means. Even we wonder who it is we are and where it is we come from, like for real. Our identity as Unitarian Universalists emerges from a long line of liberal religious history and an evolving set of ideas about what being religious means in this world in the first place. We did not make this whole thing up ourselves. Like it or not, when it comes to origin stories, we've all got them. Our liberal religious history, one way or another, is our parent ideology. Like it or not, as individuals and as ideologies, we've all got parents. We come from somewhere. And the legacy of our parents continues to impact us still. As Unitarian Universalists, our institutional parent traditions are two specific groups within the history of the radical Protestant Christian tradition, which means that when mainline Protestant congregations across the world are busy celebrating the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation this month, we rightly could be busy celebrating our own radical corners of that movement, which tore the monolith of state-sponsored Christianity back into a diverse constellation of Christianities, which is what it had always been from the start. If the first Protestants were reformers of the Christian tradition, the first Unitarians and the first Universalists were reformers of the Protestant tradition. 500 years ago, our people reformed the reformers. They were among the radical wings of the Protestant Reformation, the ones who took Martin Luther's ideas to more far-reaching conclusions than Luther himself ever intended, or indeed probably ever imagined. And the Unitarians and Universalists were ultimately brought together not because they believed the same things, but because they jointly believed in not believing what everyone else believed. They were, as the theologians might say, heterodox rather than orthodox. They chose a different way than the prevailing theological notions of their time, and doing so enabled a risk, yes, even unto death. They chose to free themselves from the confines of certain structures of belief. What they had in common in the very beginning was not a particular set of faithful affirmations, but the fact that they were heretics together. And for a number of reasons, not all of them glamorous at all, the Universalist Church of America and the American Unitarian Association merged in 1961 to create what we now know as the Unitarian Universalist Association. Thus, we are the child of two distinct and distinctly heretical Christian traditions. And as most UU parents will attest, should you care to ask them, any offspring of two heretics is bound to be a bit interesting in their own right. Like each of us, our movement was created by at least two distinct parents, each with their own values, their own voices, and their own unique and sometimes oppositional characteristics. As individuals, we ponder the legacy of our parents all the time, not always in simple ways. I personally got my mom's brown eyes and my dad's propensity to give long speeches. this same pondering of inherited legacy. It applies not just to us as individuals, but to institutions and even ideas as well. As a beloved community, our gifts from our Unitarian and Universalist forebears are just as distinct and just as much a part of who we are today. Our theological heritage is rich, and the stories of those who came before us are filled with courage and boldness. Of course, as do all gifts from one's parents, our heritage comes along with great big piles of struggle and failure and lack of perception. No inheritance comes without its tarnished silver. And those more difficult stories of falling short, those are stories of our history we need to tell too. A legacy, after all, is something of a package deal, isn't it? But we will leave the struggles for another day. I tell you about them often enough, and we grapple faithfully with all we have yet to learn. Today, I want to try to name just one great and abiding gift from each of our parent traditions, beginning with that second you in our almost absurdly long and confusing name, the Universalists. To put it plainly, the central doctrine of our Universalist forebears is the idea of universal salvation. It is the belief that all things and especially all people will eventually come into harmony with the divine. This doctrine earned early American Universalists the nickname the No-Hellers. They were quite literally that. They were Christian believers who affirmed an idea that Jesus' salvation was so complete and so all-encompassing that it claimed everyone, whether they believed in the salvific power of Jesus or not. To our Universalist forebears, heaven was the biggest tent imaginable, and everyone would end up there in the end. European and American Universalists were people who believed that God was literally love incarnate, a force that draws us all toward itself and will not let any of us go, not now, not ever, and not forever in an imagined landscape of hell. Love incarnate that was available not only to some of us, like just the nice ones, or just the successful ones, or just the ones who repented in the right way. No, love incarnate available to all of us all the time, no matter what. They removed retribution from God's toolkit. In the place of a vengeful judge, the early Universalists placed a love so great that it will get us all in the end. Because we are not uniformly, or even perhaps mostly, theistic today, because we don't all believe in a supernatural God, we modern American UUs sometimes try to rewrite history by talking about our Universalist forebearers as if their doctrine was about us and not about God. And while it's always kind of fun to interpret our personal and institutional history in ways that make it more comfy for how we feel about things now, the truth is that Universalist theology had nothing to do with how human persons were so darn lovable. In its earliest and most radical forms, the Universalist message was about God's unwillingness to stop loving us even in spite of ourselves. Through the lens of our forebears, the inherent worth and dignity of every person works, not because people are so great, but because God loves us so much, she will never let us go. Our forebears lived and died knowing that they were loved, not that they were good, not that they were perfect, not that all of their actions were somehow justified, but simply and always that they were loved. And so if I can capture hundreds, even thousands of years of Universalist theology in three words, it is simply this: you are loved. You you are loved, and whether you believe it or not, whether you affirm the existence of a God who can even love you is almost beside the point. Imagine our universalist ancestors ask us, imagine if you don't believe it, living as if those words, you are loved, have always been true and will always be true, no matter what, every moment and always. As if you never had to prove yourself again. As if everything you do that is decent and good in this world is not to give evidence to anybody else of your virtue or to earn your way into heaven, but purely and entirely to help heal the brokenness of the world. Imagine the freedom of living as if you are already enough. Hold that universalist message and come with me for just a bit longer. As we turn now to our other more famous parent, the Unitarians, knowing that this place began its life not as River Road Unitarian Universalist Congregation, but as River Road Unitarian Church. Our most immediate forebear, that first U, the Unitarian tradition from which we spring. Great and famous folks like Ralph Waldo Emerson, Margaret Fuller, Henry David Thoreau, and even a president or two were among the ranks of the Unitarian forebears in America. Heck, for a time, Harvard University itself was the center of this powerful and politically connected Unitarian elite from which we draw our history. Unitarianism in the 19th century was the religion of the thinking man and the courageous woman. It was the faith of both righteous troublemakers and moneyed aristocrats. And when Ralph Waldo Emerson, who was, by the way, a Unitarian minister before he wrote all those famous essays, when he was asked to preach a sermon to the graduating class of Harvard Divinity School in 1838, he flat blew the doors off the theological establishment, and he set in motion this deeply personal and rebellious practice that runs in the veins of every liberal church, including ours today. He told those young men, because they were all young men, although the first woman ordained in any American denomination was Olympia Brown, a Universalist, and the first openly GLBT person ordained in any American denomination was a Unitarian. He told all those men at Harvard Divinity School not to believe merely because someone else told them to believe. He warned them not to practice their faith in any way that was handed down from above, but to actually engage in a deep and personal journey. He invaded them to toss aside all precedent and meet God face to face without mediator or veil, to see the holy in the natural world, and to pursue their own visions of a better way rather than meekly following somebody else's. Live with the privilege of the immeasurable mind, he said, and that message has become an enormous part of our inheritance. The direct and unmediated experience of the holy, the application of one's own judgment and intellect to religious claims, an encounter with truth not mediated by precedent or clergy or the dictates of any person in power. Glory, hallelujah! That is what we love most to proclaim. And this is why we are so strange and so contrarian and so broad in our commitments and so difficult to pin down. This is our bedrock, the immeasurable mind. Now, to be clear, I should remind us all that the theological basis of Unitarianism, reaching back for thousands of years, even long before the Radical Reformation, the theological basis of the whole schmear is not Emersonian mysticism of the illimitable mind, though in fact it is related. The original heresy of the Unitarians is, in fact, the idea that God is one, not three, but one. That's the doctrine that our earliest Unitarian forebears lived and died for over the ages. the original heresy that eventually gave rise to Emerson and his companions, and eventually to all of us, was anti-Trinitarianism. And who really cares about anti-Trinitarianism anymore? It was a denial of the idea that God could somehow be three and be one at the same time, because the math, let's face it, didn't really work. And today, I will acknowledge that people do not get quite so worked up about anti-Trinitarianism as people did 500 years ago. If I am honest, even the Trinitarians aren't all that Trinitarian anymore. And thus our practical heritage from our Unitarian parent is not merely that God is one, but that we can, in fact, engage faithful questions through the honest exercise of our own minds and our own hearts. The real heresy and the real gift that Unitarian gives us today is the gift of a deeply personal approach to religious questions. Our forebears have taught us that we have all the tools we need to understand and experience the holy, and nobody, not even our ministers, need to tell us how to do so. Our Unitarian forebears have taught us that God's handwriting is scrawled across the whole earth, in and through science and reason and the ever-unfolding advance of human knowledge. God's handwriting, they said, is everywhere. And nobody is more qualified to read it and interpret it than you, every day, blessedly ordinary human beings. We were not born in a vacuum. We were born from strong people who dared. Two traditions that held on to radical beliefs even when the majority of society around them disagreed, even violently so. We are born from the merging of two distinct traditions that somehow created us, an unruly yet vibrantly powerful child. Two movements whose central messages were simply, you are loved and you are capable. It is as if our parents, these Unitarian and Universalist traditions that gave rise to us, it is as if our parent traditions pulled us aside on the very first day of school and gave us the very best advice any parent ever gave a child, saying to us, I love you and you can be anything you want to be. I love you, I adore you, and I always will. Thus say the Universalists. And I believe in you. I know that you are strong. Thus say the Unitarians. And together their messages combine into a theological voice that both frees us from all sorts of ancient constraints and holds us close when we need it most. We are loved. We are loved, be it by God or by one another or by a generous universe that will not stop expanding. We are capable, if not of perfection, then at least in moments of the pursuit of something more whole than we have known today. We are loved and we are capable. We are free to believe these things or not believe them. And we are encouraged by our heritage to live as if all of these things were true, as if we have always been enough, and the work is ours to do, and we do not have to prove ourselves worthy of the task. You are loved, and you are capable. And perhaps when it comes right down to it, for the bedrock beliefs that shape a community, this is and has always been enough.